login.
Accepted.
Okay, so let's start. Hi everyone, I'm very happy to be together with you in person. Last year was quite hard for us, but we are developers, we on a daily basis overcome our problems. I know that this slot is not best for you because this is just before the lunch break, but I hope that with a little help of Druid's magic, I will make you to forget about the food for the next 50 minutes. I will start with introducing of myself. My name is Michał Misiewicz, and I'm a CTO in Adatumo. On a daily basis, I am building big data system. As you can see on the photo, I am this guy. On my free time, I like running. I compete in the road races as well on the track and field competition. That's enough about me. Now let's me say a few words about the company. So we are big data software house. This was founded in 2017. And currently on board, we have 20 specialists who are familiar with our core stack, which is you can see on this photo. But if I was honest with you, since the beginning of my work in the Datumo, only one technology was closest to my heart, and this is Apache Druid. And this is the subject of today's talk. Okay, so before going to the Druid, let me start with some story about building an analytic platform for a streaming service. You can think about the streaming service like for the Netflix. So you can have your users that are using your mobile apps, computers, and television, and every action that you do in your service is tracked. So in analytics platform, we get your information about what you are doing. In a big data system, we have also some databases, like information about the user, the metadata about the movies that you are watching, and everything. So the data is pushed to the analytic platform, and on the other hand, you have a user who are interested about to see how the business is going or to make our platform better. We can even use this data to optimize our platform. Based on that events, we can optimize the storage on the CDNs. So let me add some requirements to our project because we always have requirements. In this case, we would like to build a system that is capable of ingestion of 100K events per second with a maximum latency of 10 seconds. And this is quite restricted limitation, but in big data is quite normal. And we are also aiming that the latency of our queries should be interactive. By interactive, I mean a few seconds to the milliseconds. Of course, there are some quite larger queries. It could take some longer time, but we are aiming that most of the queries should be about the seconds. Okay, so let's build that system. We have our input, which is real-time data and batch data, and we have our user. So let's start with a batch layer. So when we have a batch layer, we should export our data from databases to the distributed file system. You can choose HDFS for this purpose, but you can say that HDFS is deprecated. So let's replace it with a Ceph, which is a modern technology as a distributed system. When you have a files, it's quite hard. Not everyone can process files because we have our analysts. They are quite familiar with SQL. So let's start with an abstraction of our files. So we can create an SQL abstraction. We can create definition of our table in a Hive metastore. And then we can use a query engine of our choose, like a Trino. Trino is a modern query engine, which is a new version of a Presto SQL. It's quite fast, so let's connect our user to this system. Okay, so we have a very nice system for the batch processing. Now let's go with the real-time. So with our events. When it comes to the real-time, the state-of-the-art in big data is to use Apache Kafka for storage of real-time data. But with a Kafka, we have such a problem in the real-time analytics that there we don't have any index. So we cannot optimize our query that are using heavy filtering or aggregation. So we need some kind of a real-time data store for this purpose in order to optimize storage for us. And let's go next. And we connect to our real-time data store, our application, our users. But we have a few problems here. First of all, we don't know what technology to use. And we have seen in our customers that they can use Cassandra, they can use Elastic, or they can use InfusDB and many other technologies. But we can see that we have a problem with this, that none of this technology is optimized for our use case, that we would like to analyze 100K events per second with a 10-second latency. This technology won't scale to this to this traffic. The other problem is that our data sources, real time and the history of data, is distributed between two systems. This is not always for the user, and this is not always good for us. As a developers, we need to maintain these two systems. And there is also a third problem with this batch query engine, but more about this later. So let's dream about the perfect solution. In perfect solution, we have our data sources, we have our user, and we connect them to one perfect technology. And we are good because we have such a technology, and it's called an Apache Druid. So what Druid really is? Apache Druid is a high-performance analytic database which solves all of the human problems. And you should say that I am wrong, because this is not possible. And this is true, because Druid is perfect technology when you work with a time series immutable data. What is time series data? You probably know. You have some timestamp connected with your events about the immutability by the data. I mean that when something is generated, our event, when I watch a movie, it won't change the future. On the other hand, we have some kind of a transaction, that we have a state of our transaction. The transaction could be the new state, but after some time, it could be completed. And Apache Druid is combining three databases in one system. So Druid takes features of a time series databases, data warehouse, as well with a search system. And when you use a Druid, out of the box, you have three big data layers. You have a data loader for optimal loading of your data in the distributed system. You have optimized storage as well with the query engine. So this is quite powerful. So let's see this in a practice. And let's start with a modeling, which is logical point of a view, how Druid works. So we will start with how we can model our data. And the logical container for our data is called a data source in Druid. And it's equivalent of a relational database table. So here you have a table. We store information when something has happened, about the event type, user ID, item ID, the name of the movie that user was watched, and some metrics like duration and how many bytes our user have read. What is special about this table? That it must be flattened. You cannot have nested columns, and there is no schema enforcement. And there is one very important thing about this data source. As Druid is a time series database, you need to have a timestamp connected with your data. And every time you have a data source, you have this underscore time column, which based on which you will partition your data source, which is logical container, into physical one. And this physical chunk of the data is called a segment. And segment is created based on this time column and in conjunction with a segment granularity parameter. And this segment granularity parameter will control how big your segment will be. So on the slide, you can see that we have our data source, which is called app events, and it's consisted from the three segments. And sometimes we have a bigger data, and we end up that our segment can store a lot of data, like three gigabytes. And other day can store less data, less than 1 gigabyte. And we need to somehow overcome this problem. And in Druid, we can divide even further our data source segment by creating a partition. So you can see for the 26th of August, we have a two partition in our segment. And we are doing this because we are aiming that the size of each partition should be between 300 to 70 megabytes. This depends, of course, on the data you have. But we are aiming the processing of the one partition should not take longer than 5 seconds, because this has a big impact on the query performance in a Druid. OK, so let's go even deeper to see what really partition is, because this is the single file that you work with a Druid. So with a single partition, it's an immutable chunk of a data. So when you have this partition, you cannot longer update your records or append a new one. And this partition is stored in a columnar format, similar to how Apache Parquet is working. So this looks like this. So when you have a file that consists of 200 columns, and in your query you need to only use 5 of them, you just take directly 5 columns, and the rest data is not scanned. So this is very good optimization. So when you have 700 megabytes files, you just take 10 megabytes, for example, and you have the results. So this is pretty neat. And with each Druid column, there is associated type of the column. And this is very important in the Druid, because only if you have string columns in a Druid, Druid will automatically create a bitmap index for you during the ingestion time. And we need this index when we heavily query our data. So let's have an example when you would like to query your data and filter all of the data from the specific hour of the day. So we would ingest hour of the day as an integer. But this is problematic for us because we are aiming to have optimized filtering of our data. So in this case, we should ingest it as a string because we'll get a mid buff. And let's have a look on this example. We have a column which is called item name, and we have information about the name of the movie that user has watched. And now let's store it in columnar format. In order to do this, we need to create a free data structure. First of all, is dictionary, which will map our string values into these integers. Then we can use our dictionary in order to create array of integers, which is a columnar representation of our column. And what is nice about that when we have integers, we can very good compress this data. It's not possible with a string, but with the integer, it's quite easy. And last but not least, we have a string column, which will create a bitmap index for us, because we would like to optimize our filtering on this query. So pretty neat. And let's go next. And I have said that partition is immutable, chunk of the data. So let's go even deeper and analyze. So first of all, you can append data to existing segment in the Druid by adding new partition. And when you have such an information, you should think that you should not ingest a few records constantly, so let's say in 1 minute interval, because it will you will end up having a lot of small partition, and it will have big impact on the query time. And when we go to the update and deletion, we should remember that we are in the big data. So when we introduce update and deletion, it would have a big impact on the performance in order to make restriction. So in Druid, there is no updates, no deletion. If you want to update your records, you need to recalculate data once again. The same applies to the deletion. But we are in the big data. We are aiming for the high-performance ingestion and high-performance query. We don't care about the updates and the deletion. So if you need such a functionality, maybe use some different technology. OK, so now it's time for the casting some spells, because Druid is some magical character from the computer games. Before going to the casting spells, I would like to show you one benchmark. So we can compare Druid with a famous SQL engine on Hadoop, like Hive and the Presto, and we can get such a result. You can see that this is improvement of a Druid over the technology. So in the orange bar, you can see Druid versus Hive, and in the blue one, Druid versus Presto. So you can see when you use a Druid, you can achieve up to 5 times faster responses than the Presto. And this is quite very nice, such a thing, because Presto is quite, it's very popular technology that is very used in a Facebook, for example. Facebook has created a Presto, and Presto is heavily used. So when we see such a result, we should start ask a question, what kind of a sorcery is? And as you know, Druid can cast some spells. So let's spell a first spell. Let's cast the first spell. First spell is called rollup. The rollup is a process that during ingestion time, you can pre-aggregate your data in order to reduce size of it. So let's have a look on the example. So we have our input data, and we would like to load it to the Druid data source. So we can create such a window, which is controlled by the query granularity parameter. So we take every event from the specific minute, we do the floor on the timestamp, and now we take all the rows with the same value in the sum of the columns, and we apply some reduction function. So you can see that, let's focus on these two orange rows, that we floor the timestamp, we take all the events with the streaming, with type of the streaming event, and item ID with a one. And we pull to the end, and then we apply some reduction function. So we can sum duration of the events. As well, we put information about how many events was included in the rollup. So if I would summarize it, so the final Druid data source is consisting of three types of a column. First of them is called a timestamp, which is our magic time column. The second one is the dimensions. So the dimensions are the columns based on which we do the aggregation. And our reduction function are called the metrics. So this is how you would represent data source in a Druid. Using the rollup, we can drastically reduce the size of our data, which has a very important factor on the processing time. But you can say that when I do the aggregation, I'm losing resolution for analyzing of the individual records. And this is problematic for some of the use cases, but not in the analytic platform. So let's go deeper, and we can take all of our data and apply different segment granularity and query granularity. So we have a bigger rollup for our history of our data, and we have a smaller rollup for the new data. And you can say that we can analyze our latest month of our data with a minute granularity, how our business is going minute by minute. But when we have a data which is older, like 6 months ago, we can only analyze it day by day. But in practice, who cares what was most popular movie 1 year ago at 3 p.m.? In practice, nobody. You would even maybe don't care what was popular movie in the specific day, rather maybe year or the month. So we can drastically reduce our data, and we can make big data small again. Okay, so let's go next. Because for me, big data is not about how much data you have, but it's rather about how you work with the data, what is your ecosystem, and what is your culture working with the data. When somebody says that have very bigger data, it's not because it can have a lot of data, a lot of garbage data. So this was the first part, that we can drastically reduce the size of our data and have a better performance. So now let's go with a second problem. So we have our data source, and let's focus on the last column, which takes information how many active users was active in the last period. And when you do a rollup, we have information that there was almost 10,000 users that was streaming Mandalorian at 11:25. But now we would like to analyze how many active users were in the specific day. But now we have a problem, that when we have such aggregation, we cannot just add it, because this is not how the active user works. So we need to store information about every unique value in order to calculate this on the runtime. So we have a quite problem. So maybe we can store them, store everything. But when we store everything, we have a very large number of bytes to store. But we have also another problem, that in order to calculate this, we need to take every our data in one node. And this is very bad in a big data system, because we are introducing a bottleneck. So what to do this with this problem? Fortunately for us, there is a data structure called data sketches, and it's optimized for solving this problem in an approximate fashion. So we can use the data sketches in order to solve count distinct problem, as well with the histograms and the quantiles. And data sketches work like this, that you can distribute all of your data data set, and you can create some data structure, which is which can estimate the size of the cardinality of your data set based on the reduced amount of the data. So you could have 10 billions of users, and you can only store, let's say, 100,000 of user IDs. To be honest, it's hash user ID, but it doesn't matter. And based on this 100,000 events, you can estimate the whole cardinality of your data set. So this is pretty neat, because you're reducing the size. So let's analyze the pros and cons. First of all, when you're using a data sketches, you have very small footprint of your data. And last, the next one is that you have a better speed because you can parallelize your processing. Going back to the Facebook, they have such a problem that sometimes ago they tried to analyze how many users was seen some advertise. And these queries, in order to calculate, it takes hours to be calculated. It's not very hard query, but this is count distinct problem. This is very problematic in big data. But when they apply data sketches, they reduce this time to the minutes. The next thing with the data sketches, that we can have a control over how big error we can get in our result, because as I have mentioned, the data sketches are approximate, but we have this LGK parameters, which is logarithm of k, and this defines how many numbers we are store in order to estimate our data set. So if we take the LGK equal to 16, we have store over 65,000 of unique values in order to estimate. And when we do estimation, we can be sure that our estimation have maximum error of 1.17 with a 99% of the confidence. And this is only one cons of using data sketches. They are approximate by nature. At many times, business will tell you that this is not usable for them because they need to have an exact result. But you should ask yourself a question: if you have 1% error of your data, if you can still make a good business decision. Because most of the time, you can do this. So this was the second spell of the Druid. And now I would like to give some tips about how to migrate to the Druid. First of all, forget about your old system and start thinking about how Druid is working. So you should optimize your data source and your data to load it to the Druid. So you probably should enable the rollups, because you will get a lot of data, a lot of performance by only reducing the data, which you will never use in practice, because who is interested with all data which is older than half a year? Maybe machine learning, maybe not. So let's reduce the size and get the performance. And the next thing, you should avoid loading high cardinality dimension. And high cardinality dimension, and a good example is a user ID. We have billions of user IDs in our system. If we would ingest it, it will be broke down the rollup. But we can use data sketches in order to solve the problem. Because we are loading user ID, not to care about the specific user, but we are looking at the whole group of the user. So maybe we can load the region in which user is living, age of the user, and now we can do all of our stuff in order to segment our user, but we can do this much more quicker. And this is all about the modeling data in the Druid, and now let's see how Druid works in the practice, because we are in the big data, so this is probably a big distributed system. And for me, as an architect, Druid is a perfect implementation of the microservice system. In a DevOps, we have quite a lot talks about how the distributed microservices are working, how to create them, and let's build a data warehouse, which is a distributed microservice system. So first of all, let me introduce you to the native Druid components. There are six of them, and if I would explain all of, maybe more about this later. But we can divide our six native components into three groups. First of them can be called the master servers, and they are mind of the Druid. They are responsible for the management and balancing of the segment between all of our cluster. The second group of our servers can be called a data servers. So we have this server as responsible for the storing the data, because we want to store our data on the disk, and they are also ingesting the data. So this data servers are storing and ingesting the data. And the last but not least, we have our query servers, who are responsible for speaking with our clients and to distribute the querying to the whole Druid cluster. And these are only native Druid components, and this native components doesn't give you any kind of a persistence, because Druid for the persistence is using an external dependency. So first of this dependency is called a metadata storage. And this metadata storage stores all of your information, metadata, about the segment that you have already ingested to the Druid. And in a metadata storage, we don't store your data. We only store the metadata. So the data we store in a deep storage. You can use MySQL or Postgres to implement metadata storage. And now let's go to the deep storage. And the deep storage is place when you put your data. And the deep storage is a reliable place for you, because once you ingest data to the Druid, it will be stored in the deep storage. And then it's not possible to lose your data. You can even remove all your Druid native nodes. And the data, if it's available in the deep storage, it will survive. So you can do this like this, that you can have data in your deep storage. You can remove all your nodes and redeploy in a different region. Of maybe you have data in Europe, you can migrate your Druid cluster to Asia, and Druid will pull off the data, and the data will be available. So this is quite nice in the practice, and the implementation of a deep storage is a distributed file system of your choice. So you can use a cloud one, you can use some on-premise one with S3 API implementation. Okay, so we are almost end the architecture of the Druid, but we need last component for the service discovery and the coordination of the processing between the services. And in big data, the most popular technology is called the Zookeeper for that purpose. But you should be aware that in the newest version of the Druid, you could replace Zookeeper with a Kubernetes API in order to use power of the Kubernetes to solve this problem easily. Now, if I would need to explain how Druid works, and in this diagram, it will be a nightmare for you, and it will be also a nightmare for me, because there is a lot of service and a lot of dependency between them. So I rather would go by the user functionality that you will need in order to show you how Druid works. So first of all, we need to load data to the Druid. And now let's start with a batch data, which could be three Parquet files that stores data from the 2 days. When we have our Parquet file, we introduce the overlord, who is the mind of the ingestion process. He is responsible of the distribution of the ingestion between our distributed system into Druid nodes, and especially they are called the middle manager. So here we have two middle managers that are taking the data and are creating a segment. Each of the middle manager have a processing slot, so each of our middle manager can process two files, and they have also local disk storage. Why? More about this later. So these are the native components. Now the external dependency. We have a deep storage, which will be used for storing the segments as the output in a reliable place. And we also need a metadata storage in order to publish our segments for the whole cluster and to be available for the processing in a Druid. OK, so these are all the components. Now let's go how it works. So first of all, we do the REST call to overlord to say that we want to ingest some data. Overlord will create a supervisor for us. So we can see that this light blue rectangle is our supervisor. And this supervisor will analyze the input and will create some ingestion tasks, which are similar to MapReduce task. So we have a map task, which takes one of the file. Each of the map tasks will get a file. So we are distributing the processing between our map task, and each of them will start the processing. So now you can see that our segments are processing. After some time, our processes end, and they will save the result, partial result, to our local disk. And we are doing this because we don't know how the data is distributed in our files. So we need to shuffle the data in order to make sure that we'll end up with a good segment. And we can do this with a reduce task. So we are creating a reduce task, two, because we would like to output three segments. And so the data is shuffled between the reduce task. And the output of the reduce task are the segment files that are handed to the deep storage. So we are not longer storing on the local disk. We are serving this in a deep storage. And last phase of the ingestion process of a batch data is to make this data available for the other nodes, which are responsible for the query part. And we do this like this. The supervisor will remove all of the tasks and will put an information in the metadata storage that, hey, Druid cluster, you have two new segments. You should take it and handle it with our queries. OK, so this is end of the ingestion process of a batch data. But as I have mentioned, we have also a real-time data. So let's see how we can work with a real-time. With a real-time, the Druid components are the same, but we have a different input. We no longer have a files, but we have a Kafka topic, maybe Kafka cluster. In this case, we have only one Kafka topic with a free partition. So the flow is very similar. So we'll start with a supervisor. Now supervisor will live in overlord, but this is like an implementation detail. And the first phase is to discover the metadata about our Kafka topic partition. So here we can see that we have a free Kafka topic partition. So let's create a free map task. Each of them will get one partition assignment. So we assign this one to partition to this and like this. After that, before even starting the processing, supervisor will publish the segment. Why we do this? Because we don't even start the processing, but we already have announced that our nodes can answer some queries. And we do this because we are doing a real-time processing. We cannot save our result to the deep storage because this is not longer a real-time. We need to answer a query about this data as soon as is possible. So we first publish the segments, and then we start the processing. So now you can see that each of the map tasks is taking all of the data from the specific Kafka partition, and it's working. When we have our user who is interested for about the fresh data, they can start asking the question. And the questions are going to our middle managers because they are serving the real-time data. We don't, the data is not in the deep storage. Everything is on the local disks of our middle managers. Okay, so we know how to ingest, we know how to query, and after some time, this data is no longer, it should be hand off to the deep storage, because you will end up with a whole big file, like 10 gigabytes or 10 terabytes. So there is some timer that will finish, there is some timer that will stop the processing of the real-time data, and on this time, every of the map tasks will stop and will hand off the segments to the deep storage. And it's here is very important that you don't longer have a reduce task, because still, this is a real-time. You then don't have time to do the reduction, so each of your segments for the specific real-time ingestion task will be have such a number of partition, which is equal to the number of the map task. And after we have these three files, now the supervisor can say that these segments are handoff, the segment partition, to be more specific, and now the other nodes of the Druid cluster can take this data and do something with it. Okay, so we know how to load the batch data, we know how to load the real-time data, so now let's go with the data querying part. Before doing the querying part, we need to fetch the data. And with the fetch of the data, we start that we have our metadata storage with a segments table. It has information about all of the segments that are available in the deep storage. So we have ingested some data, so this segment table will reference the data on the deep storage. And now we would like to make our querying faster, so we would like to preload this data to our local disk, not reliable on some maybe cloud distributed file system. So we'll introduce a historical. Here I also use two historical nodes, and each of them has a local disk, very fast with SSD, probably it will be better for us, and it will prefetch after some time. But before we do the prefetching, we need to coordinate the whole process. So we'll start with a coordinator, who is similar to the overlord when it comes to the balancing of the cluster. And the last but not least, we have some medium of the communication, and for Druid we'll use a zookeeper. So in a zookeeper we have a load queue path, and let's see how it works. So our coordinator will periodically check the segment table, and based on this information, it will create a load queue. So it detects that there are three files on the deep storage that are not stored by the historical. So we can see that the load queue was populated, and now our historical all of the time are tracking this load queue. And based on this information, they will prefetch the data to the local disk. Okay, so it's always better to have data precached on the local disk. Maybe it's not a memory, but it's also quite good. But there is also one important thing in the Druid, when you are on the Linux, there is also page cache mechanism. So with page cache, when you have some free memory, you can use to store your recent data that was available on the disk on the memory. And when you have an interactive system, when you do the analytics, you're starting with some basic query, for example, what is the top movie in the specific region, and then you go deeper. So you reuse the same data, but you do the different queries. And all of the time, the same data is required. And if you use this into take this into the account, you can expect that these files will be stored in the memory, not in the disk, in the memory. So this is also a good improvement for us. But let's go next. So our historical, when we prefetch our segments, the last thing that historical need to say, announce that they are storing the specific segment for the specific day. So let's do this, and we have the segments path in the zookeeper, and based on this information, we can do the query part. So let's go to the query part. We have our end user who is interested about what are the top most popular movies in the latest 28 hours. So in this query, we are requiring to have a real-time data as well with a batch data. So we'll need to contact a middle manager and a historical. Okay, this is quite obvious. We have also information about the segments distribution in the zookeeper, which Druid node to contact, and we have also a broker, who is the guy to contact when we have a query to be executed. So let's see what are the most 10 popular movies. So we'll ask a broker. Broker will analyze our query. And based on the query, it will start to detect which nodes of the Druid to contact with in order to get a final result. So based from the zookeeper, it has information which nodes it should contact. And now it can distribute our query into our processing cluster. So let's do this. We do the distribution, we contact the middle manager, we contact the historical, and now each of them will process our query. So they are processing, and after some time they will do the partial result and return it to the broker. Now broker merge this task, this result, and return a final result to our end user. Quite easy, quite powerful, because here we have a partition pruning. We are dividing our database on the timestamp, so we don't need to scan all of our files. We are only using files which are needed. Okay, so we know how to load data, we need to how to distribute the data, we know to how to query data. So we have whole big data system, whole data warehouse implemented as a microservice system. So in this use case, there is no single point of a failure. Even if all of the nodes for the specific type, for example, middle manager will break down, you cannot no longer ingest new data for the Druid, but the data is available. Your history of your data is still there. So your whole cluster is working. You cannot only ingest the data. This is a problem, but you can fix it. And the business doesn't even care because they maybe are interested not on the history. And the last part about the architecture, about how we can contact, how we can talk with a Druid. And in a Druid, we have two languages. First one is called a Druid SQL, which is implementation of ANSYS SQL. It's a subset of the implementation. There are some features connected only to the Druid, so this is not a standard. And this is the powerful one because SQL is a king. Everyone knows SQL. And there are also the second language, which is called a native queries. And these native queries are low-level query engine, and you can use them in order to optimize your query. So the native queries were since the beginning in the Druid, but the SQL was added in the newer version. And when we have our SQL queries, they are always translated to the native queries on the broker. But you should be aware that sometimes the translation is not very good, and you can explain your query in order to see how Druid will execute this. And when it comes to the interfaces that you can speak by REST, and you can speak by JDBC. So this is quite standard, nothing, no magic, but it's very powerful. Okay, so we come to the architecture, we have covered the modeling. Now let's see Druid in action. I still have some minutes, so let's do some live demo. Okay, you probably see my screen. Okay, so this is a Druid console. So you can see that this is quite nice UI. It wasn't from the start. The start UI was quite ugly, let's say, but the new one is quite cool. And let's start with services, because we need to first make sure what are our nodes in our Druid cluster. So we are going to the service tab, and you can see that I have one Druid component of each type. And the last one from the list is the new one that I haven't explained. But this task, which are called Peon, to be honest, it's not the best name for the service, but forget about it. And the Peon is implementation of a map task. So on this data ingestion part, so Peon is this map reduce that we are implementing. OK, so we have a working Druid cluster. We have some left space on our cluster. So let's load some data. And we'll load data from the Apache Kafka. Yes, of course. Is it okay now? Or even bigger? Maybe this one. Okay, so we have multiple of inputs that we can use in our for data loading in the Druid. So we can use Apache Kafka, we can use Amazon Kinesis, Azure Event Hub, or some storage like Delta Lake in Azure Cloud Storage, or HDFS. And you can also load data, ranges data from the Druid. And this is very nice when you would like to delete some data. You can re-index the data, so you can take data from the existing segment, and you can reduce the number of columns or filter out some of the rows. So you can add the filter predicate that will eliminate some of the rows. The update is not supported, but for the deletion, it's quite powerful. So let me start with a Kafka. So I connect. First of all, I need to specify the Kafka cluster. So I will contact to the Bootstrap server. In my case, why this is uppercase? This is Kafka, port 9901, and the topic should be called card payments. Because now we would like to load data about the card payments. This is quite a simpler domain than media events. So let me do this in a, also shortest of the time, I will show the card payments data. So when I apply, you should connect to the data, to the Kafka topic, and you can see the data. So you can see a lot of JSON. This is sample data from the Kafka topic. So now let's unparse it. So I'm going to the next step. Android out of the box will detect that this is the JSON and create a columnar representation of the JSON for me. So we have information about the amount for the transaction. We have information about the business type of our the user which use our terminal. We have information about the card type, currency. We have information about our user and some identifier. And timestamp, this is very important. So let's see how we can ingest this data to the Druid. First of all, we need to create this magical time column. So we'll parse our data and choose that this timestamp column will be our underscore time column. So Druid out of the box correctly detect this. So let's go next. We don't do this any kind of a transformation, but you can in practice do any row level transformation in the Druid during the ingestion time. So this is also quite powerful. We don't filter anything. So now let's go to the configure the schema part, because this is very important. First thing, enable the rollup, because by default, Druid won't enable the rollup, and it means that you only have a dimension. So enable the rollup. Yes, I'm sure that I want the rollup. And let me specify the query granularity, which for the real time is quite good to have a minus granularity. So I will pre-aggregate, I will lose resolution to query my data second by second, but minute by minute is quite okay for me. I don't need any bigger resolution. And let me analyze what I have out of the box. I have a time, I have a business type, this looks promising, and I have an aggregation. I have a count of the events and amount, sum of amount, but I have a problem with a terminal ID and user ID. In this data set, this is about 200k different values. So let me remove these columns because it will break my rollup. So I will remove this one. I will remove this one. But I will add a matrix, like data sketches for this, in order to know how many unique user was included in the rollup and how many unique terminal was there. So let me add a matrix, name it active users, no spell. And I will use a data sketch, which is called hyperlocklog. This is quite powerful and one of the best optimized for the count distinct problem. So let me choose the name of it. So I will, this was user, based on the user ID from the input of our data. I have information about the LGK. Let's leave it to the 12 and I will apply it. And now you can see that I have additional column. I don't have information about how many unique user was there. But this is a data structure. So when you will encode it, you have you can merge these rows and have a final to get the final data structure based on which you can estimate the size. And let's go next. Now I can specify the segment granularity, which is time of our ingestion real-time task. So there was a timer in the slides, and this when this timer will appear, it's controlled by the segment granularity. So I will choose the hour. Now is the tuning part. I will skip this part. Maybe I will only specify this. And the last but not least is to specify the name of the data source. In this case, it's called card payments, the same as for the Kafka topic. And we can say OK. And now we have a final configuration of our ingestion task. It is always represented in the JSON. You can take this JSON, put it in a Git repository, and you can automate this process. For the real time, maybe it's not as useful, but if you have a batch processing that you are loading a bunch of the files every hour, it's good to have some script which will automate this. to dynamically put some parameter like interval. There's forget about this because this is a real time for the batch. And now I could submit it, but I have already do this because I would like to show a little bit more of the data, not starting from this point, because from the Druid we in a Kafka we don't have a whole history of our data, only let's say 1 hour, because this is costly to have everything. So from the load table, let me go to the ingestion table. And now you can see that why I have one supervisor, which is of type of a Kafka. So this is probably Kafka ingestion. I have information that this is card payments data source, and it's taking data from the card payment data Kafka topic, and it's in a running status. So let's see what's happening here. We have information about the total number of processed rows by this task. We have information about 1 minute, and this is aggregate. So it means that we have 8K requests per second process. So this is quite nice. And you can see that here are a lot of tasks, and each of these tasks will take 1 hour because I have configured the segment granularity to be 1 hour. But you have also need to hand off the segment and to upload it to the deep storage. So this is why this task takes more than 1 hour. And about 1 and 2 minutes additional more. Okay, so I should have some data. So maybe I have a data source, last but not least. This data source is called card payments, and I have 372 segments. Total size of the data source in Android is 15 gigabytes. In the input data, it will be hundreds of gigabytes. And the granularity of the segment is hour. So I can see the segments, size of each segment type. But let's go to the querying part. So first of all, I can do some simple select that I have a data, but we are not using Druid for the selecting part. Let's do some aggregation. So let me analyze what is the best business type in our business. So you can see that the largest amount of the transaction are done in the restaurant, gas station, grocery store, and the least are done in the gym. Okay, so. And what is nice, that every time I run, the results are updating. So with Druid, when the data is available on the Kafka topic, Druid, as fast as possible, it will load this data. And you can see that you can use SQL in order to query your data. You can even see the explain query in order to see how it's mapped to the native queries. So we can see that there is a query of top N type, but this is quite deeper knowledge, so forget about this. And I want to also to show you what is the roll-up ratio of our data, because we are aggregating our data by minute in a roll-up window, and we have also enabled the data sketches. So let me show my query. Maybe do I have this one? Okay, I can write it out, this one. So I can now check about how many rows was in our input of our data, and how, which is sum of the count. This is my metric. And I can count the number of rows in a Druid data source. And if I divide this, I will get information about the rollup. So with the rollup, I get 10. So it means that on the Druid, I store 10 times less data than if I start with the second granularity. And this is very nice because I have 10 times less data source, data set. Okay, so we can query, but the SQL and this UI is not perfect for the interactive analytics. And let me introduce to the open source interactive tool, which is called the Turnilo. Turnilo is open source by Allegro and constantly developed. And with the Turnilo, you can interactively analyze your data source. And this tool is using whole power of the Druid, because it's using the native queries interface. And you can see this even in the UI. So you have a dimension, you have a measure, you have a timestamp. This is how it looks in the Druid. So this is perfect for us. So we can see that we have a 50-100 millions of transaction. And let's see how it goes in time. So we can split our data by the time. And we can see that the number of the transaction is changing. So we can see that the peak of our traffic was in 2 p.m. We are in the Warsaw time zone. Okay, so we have a peak of our traffic in the 2 p.m. You have another peak in the 6 p.m. We have information about the number of transactions per second. So in a peak, we have a 13K request per second. And the total amount, the total balance of all the transactions is 19 billion. So it's quite big. And now if I would like to see how the business is working, oh, nice. Always in the... Okay. Oh, I don't have connection to the internet. Let me connect to the DevOps once again. Sorry for that. Almost to the end, last part. One last try. Okay, sorry for that, so let me go. I wanted to show you that with a Druid, if I have internet connection, maybe I can quickly connect to my hotspot. Two minutes and I will finish, so don't worry. You will be on your break, lunch break. Let me show, okay, so I should be up. Let me do the refresh. Okay, so I'm back, and let me split our data source by business type. You can see this was quite an interactive query, and now I can see the distribution of my data in such a nice plot. So I can, if I doesn't know this domain, I can take some insight. So I can see that the grocery stores are generating a lot of the transaction, but the total balance of this transaction is quite small. So in this, the biggest total balance of the transaction has an e-commerce shops. So this is quite obvious, but if you doesn't know the domain, this is quite powerful. And last but not least, I would like to also show you the last thing that you can count your approximate metrics. You can, for example, see the number of unique users and unique terminal that was used in a specific day, and you can also compare it with how it goes one hour later. So let me do this like this, and you can see uniques are quite harder to calculate, but you can see that now our business is quite going quite slower than that we expect. And that's it from my presentation. So let me go to the slides. So I would like to thank you very much for attending my talk. Happy reading, and thank you very much.